Hello, we're one half of the Verona Quartet. He's Jonathan.
And he's also Jonathan.
We're delighted to be performing for the Freya Gallery and bringing you music by Reena Esmail, Stravinsky, and Beethoven's monumental String Quartet, Opus 131, number 14 in C sharp minor.
The first piece we'll be playing for you is Reena Esmail's String Quartet titled Ragamala. And we thought no one better to tell you about the piece than Reena Esmail, the composer herself. So enjoy.
Hi everyone, my name is Reena Esmail, and I'm the composer of this string quartet titled Ragamala. So this is a series of four vignettes, and each vignette is in a specific rag. So a rag in Hindustani classical music is a little bit like a scale in Western music, but it's also so much more than that. So it's a series of melodies that are kind of interconnected. There's a really specific way of navigating through them. And, you know, sometimes it has a really specific mood, a flavor, kind of a fragrance to it. It also has a specific time of day and, you know, sometimes even a season of the year. So Ragamala is made up of two words. The first one is raga and the other is mala. So mala is like a chain, and it's almost like a chain of flowers, what we might consider a lei or something. And in this case, each flower is a specific rag, hence the word ragamala. And it's interesting to me because that word is as common in Hindustani music as the word string quartet is in classical music. And I love this kind of idea of having these iconic concepts. We all know what a string quartet is in Western classical music, and everyone in Hindustani music knows what ragamala is. So I like these familiar concepts that we can kind of translate across cultures. So each of these movements, like I said, is in a different rag, but it's also processed through a Western lens. And that's not only because of the performers that perform it, but it's also the way that you're hearing it. Now, I like the idea that two people could be sitting right next to each other, maybe even virtually next to one another, and listening to this piece and be hearing something completely different just because of the way that they've been trained to hear music and because of their own cultural context. And my real hope is that those two people might kind of, at the end of the piece, turn towards each other and begin a conversation.
Thank you.
Thank you. So now we come to Stravinsky's Concertino for String Quartet. Stravinsky didn't write a traditional string quartet, not a piece that was sort of 25 minutes in length in various movements. What he does in this particular piece is he boils down the bare elements right to the bone, and he reimagines the classical sonata form structure in a new way for the roaring 1920s. It's full of vibrancy and jazzy, off the beaten path rhythms on either side of the piece, and then in the middle is a very wistful, almost sad violin cadenza. And a little bit about that is the first violinist himself who'll be playing on it.
Right, well, Stravinsky's always been my favorite composer because he's just so innovative, so unconventional in his approach to writing music. And it's no different in the concertino for string quartet. How often does a violinist have to play a cadenza in the middle of a string quartet? Almost never. And Stravinsky very clearly notates that instead of playing the entire double stop cadenza on the A and E strings, which would make it a lot easier, Stravinsky says to play it on the A and the D string, which means I have to go high up in the stratosphere on the violin. It gives the music an almost strained, pained sound and expression, which really befits the mood. So we hope you enjoy this piece. It's one of our favorites, Stravinsky's Concertino for String Quartet.
Hi, I'm Dorothy.
I'm Abigail.
And the final piece on the program tonight is Beethoven's Mammoth Opus 131 String Quartet. And, you know, this is one of the greatest masterpieces in all string quartet literature. And what I love about this piece is this duality between the intricate, intimate sentiments and the overarching, expansive musical scope.
With the Opus 131 Quartet of Beethoven, we return to a piece that's presented in a through-composed form. So where one movement, in this case I would call them sections rather than movements, flows one into the next without a pause. And in this sense, it gives the feeling of almost like a stream of consciousness, as if Beethoven has looked inward to himself and is really considering a topic very seriously and very personally and expressing it in its most natural form. In fact, this quartet was really a response for him to frustration in the way that he had been composing before. Hard to believe, right? Now, we could go on and on in great detail as to how this incredible piece is put together, and we'll invite you into our rehearsal room one day for more discussion on that topic. But a couple things I find so amazing about this piece. It's in C-sharp minor, but it ends in C-sharp major. Now, that's not a spoiler. Probably many of you have heard it. But not only that, it's not just the ending that stands out. The way it begins with this very rigorous, formal kind of fugue. It really sets us off on this tone of seriousness, and yet we experience, as Dorothy said, incredible highs, these incredible joyful moments that only Beethoven could express exactly that way, and these incredibly personal and oftentimes very romantic moments as well. So it's a gem of a piece. We absolutely love it. We know you will too.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.